He is risen. I want to welcome you to this online service for Oakhurst EV Free, and we're so glad that you are joining us as we celebrate Christ's resurrection. You know, we are living in a season right now where there are a lot of things that we are reminded that we don't know. We don't know how long these shelter-in-place orders are going to last. We don't know the future of our own health and the future of the health of our loved ones. We don't know what everything's going to look like when this is all over. We don't know if there's even going to be a second or a third wave of this. There are a lot of things that we don't know. But we are reminded today of the most important thing that we do know, that we know that Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. And that makes all the difference, doesn't it? We know that Jesus has conquered sin and death so that we can have assurance of eternal life with him if we have repented of our sin and placed our trust and our faith in him as Lord and Savior. And we know that the risen Savior rules as the sovereign King of the universe. And so all these things that we don't know are in his good and sovereign hands. We know that he is risen. And so as we celebrate this Resurrection Sunday, this Easter Sunday, that we place our hope and our joy in the certainty of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's what we're celebrating today. Now, as I've said before, these videos, what we're doing, that's not church. It's not the church. The church is the people, the blood-bought sinners that Jesus died and raised for. And it's more importantly, not just the individuals, but it's also the way that the Bible uses that word church is the gathered assembly of God's people. And we're not gathered. I'm standing here in a fairly empty sanctuary. And so we long. There's something about this time that should make us long for when we are gathered again. But yet, even while we're apart, there are still things that we can do that we are growing in our love for the Lord and celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that we would grow in our knowledge of the truth and then letting that truth of the resurrection impact our lives. So we want to make these videos so that we can hear God's word preached about the resurrection of Jesus Christ as the word is read today and as the word is preached by Pastor Bob today. That we want to sing these songs that we're singing today, that we sing to God in thankfulness to him for what he's done and giving us that eternal life through Jesus, but also we are singing to ourselves and to any of those that are in your home with you. But we're singing to our own hearts these truths. Now, I know for some of you being at home, it's kind of weird singing to a television. I get you. Not everyone's weird like the Shigio family. The songs come on and we're just belting it out and we can't even hear the TV because the Shigio family is just singing as loud as we can. We sing as loud, maybe louder there than we do here at church. But I want to encourage you, if you haven't been singing with us these last couple weeks, don't worry about if it's weird or not. Sing to the Lord. Sing to the Lord these truths and thankfulness to him of the resurrected Savior. Sing to your own hearts that you would sing these truths about who Jesus is and what he's done to encourage your own hearts during this time. And during this time, we're also reminded that we need to be edified by one another. And so if you haven't checked out our video chat group that we have going on of different Bible studies and ministries throughout the week, if you have the technological ability to join us, we would love for you to try and check that out this week. You can find information about when those are on the church website, and you can find out more information about how to join some of those groups through the newsletter that goes out. And if you're not signed up for the newsletter, please contact Trish in the church office, and she'll make sure you get signed up for that newsletter. Also, we're starting a new group. We want to have groups available throughout the week with different responsibilities and things going on. And so Pablo and Karen Hermosilla are going to be starting a new fellowship group. Not as much of a Bible study, but more of a group of encouragement and prayer and a fellowship that's going to happen on Saturday nights. So if you're interested in participating with that, we're kind of seeing how much interest there's going to be for that. Please reach out to Pablo and Karen, or you can also get their information from the church office if you're interested in joining that new fellowship group. And if you don't have a computer or phone that allows you to video chat, that's okay. We would encourage you to still keep in touch, still keep in contact with people. Call people and encourage them, pray for them. Let them encourage you and pray for you. We have just a couple other announcements, as I said. If you're not signed up for emails and reminders in the newsletter, please contact Trish in the church office to make sure that you are connected in with what's going on in our church. Also, as a reminder that we're not taking offering this morning, as you're in your homes and not here together, so we can't pass the offering plate. But I'd encourage you to remember that the ministry of the church is still continuing. As we would continue to minister to the things that are going on here in our community and to our church body, as our missionaries are still ministering around the world, the ministry still continues. So I'd pray that you would continue to store up treasure in heaven and that you would continue to give financially to what the church is doing here. You can contribute either digitally through the webpage or the online app the phone app for our church, or you can mail your giving into the church here. And you know, as we go through this uncertain time, I want you to remember, as I've been saying every week, that our elders, we love you, and that our elders are praying for you. And that we are longing for the day that we can once again gather here together. We don't know when that day is going to be, but we trust the future into the good and sovereign hands of the risen King Jesus. And so we can celebrate this day that he is risen. And in fact, Kevin Lockwood has prepared a special little video of people who have sent in their greetings for this Resurrection Day. And we're gonna see that now before we enter into our worship service.
Have a great day.
Happy Resurrection Day.
He is risen.
Happy Easter, church family.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hi, church family.
I miss you.
Happy Resurrection Sunday.
I'm going to call us to worship from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Let me read that for us. Peter writes, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Father, we thank you. We thank you that we have a living hope in the objective truth of the living Savior, your son, Jesus Christ, who you rose from the dead. We thank you that we have hope in him because of the life he purchased for us. So we praise you now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Again, our glorious King, hallelujah.
I introduced this next song last week. It's a new song called Christ, Our Hope in Life and Death. It's modeled after the first question of the Heidelberg Catechism that parents used for generations to teach their children the truths of the Christian faith. And that question, as I said last week, was, what is your only comfort, your only hope in life and death? And that answer is that I am not my own, but belong with body and soul, both in life and death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. And what a perfect Easter song, isn't it? Because that's what it means, is we've placed our trust in Christ, our hope in life and in death, and no matter what comes, is in the risen Savior.
What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, what is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong, who holds our days within His hand. What comes apart from His command, and what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand. What shall we sing? Christ He lives, and what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with Him, then we will rise to meet the Lord, then sin and death will be destroyed, and we will feast in endless joy when Christ is ours forevermore.
Scripture today is actually two different places. We'll be reading from Luke chapter 23, verses 38 through 43, and then I'll also be reading from Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. There was a written notice above him which read, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth. Today, you will be with me in paradise." And now in chapter 24. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene and Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women, because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. Lord, what amazing verses these are. I love the story, God, about Jesus hanging there and telling this man beside him that he would be with him that day in paradise. It reminds me that Jesus had the authority to say that. He was God incarnate. He is the giver of eternal life. And because he proclaimed that that man would be with him in paradise, that man was with him in paradise and is to this day and forevermore. And God, that's where we have put our hope. Those of us who believe in Christ, all of our hope, all of our trust is in that, that he is the author of life, that he is the one who has the authority to forgive our sins because he died for them and he was raised again. And as we read about this scene where these women went into this tomb and it was empty and suddenly these angels stood before them, what an amazing scene this was. And to think this is not just a story that we recite over and over again. This was a moment in time that actually happened. These women saw this. And Peter ran into that tomb and it was empty. He saw that empty tomb as well. And we know, God, that afterwards they saw the risen Christ. And not just them, but there was even over 500 other people that saw him alive again. And this is where we place our hope. We thank you so much that he has died for us and that he is risen again and is alive forevermore. And that because of that, we will live for him or with him forever in paradise. And these are words that we live for, God. This is everything to us. We thank you for it. And on a day like this, though there are so many other things that we could be praying for, I want to leave it at that. Thank you for Christ. Thank you for the sacrifice he made, and thank you for the resurrection. In Jesus' name, amen.
He became sin, who knew no sin,
that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all, Jesus Messiah. Lord of all. Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Alleluia, what a Savior. His name.
That's what we celebrate in the risen Christ, right? No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, we will stand. Before we enter entire time studying God's word, the sermon, Jalea Fairfield has a special music to play for us to focus us on this resurrection day.
sacrifice to conquer every sting of death. Sing, sing hallelujah. What joy awakes as dawning light when Christ's disciples lift their eyes. Alive he stands, their friend and king. Christ, Christ, he is risen. Christ is risen, he's risen indeed. Oh, sing hallelujah. Join the chorus, sing with the redeemed. Christ is risen, he's risen indeed. Where doubt and darkness once had been, they saw him and their hearts believed. But blessed are those who have not seen, yet sing hallelujah. Once bound by fear, now bold in faith, they preach the truth and power of grace. And pouring out their lives, they gain life, life everlasting. Now works in us to powerfully save. He frees our hearts to live his grace. Go tell of his goodness. Christ is risen, he's risen indeed. Oh, sing hallelujah. Join the chorus, sing with the redeemed. Christ is risen, he's risen.
Happy Resurrection Sunday. As I understand it, this is the first Easter in the history of the United States where we really haven't met together, but we're meeting on line thanks to Kevin Lockwood and a bunch of other guys here, and we're excited because he is risen. He is risen indeed. Now, on this Resurrection Sunday, I'd like you to turn your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 53, and we'll be looking at what many consider the greatest messianic prophecy in the Old Testament, if not in the Bible. For in this chapter entitled The Suffering Servant, we have a clear spelling out of our Lord's earthly life. We see his incarnation, his presentation to his people Israel. We see his rejection by his people Israel. We see his death and burial, his resurrection and ultimate glorification, and the implications that had for his salvific or salvation work. And as I studied this, I came to the conclusion that Isaiah 53 is a synopsis of the entire New Testament in one chapter, because to a greater or lesser degree, it includes everything revealed in the New Testament from Matthew to the book of Revelation, from our Lord's humiliation as God became man and took on the form of a servant, to his exaltation when his glory was restored in the book of Revelation. So this is like a one-chapter review of the entire New Testament as well as much of the Old Testament. Now, let me clear up something right off. Isaiah 53 is not referring to Israel as the suffering servant, either contextually or hermeneutically or in any way you want to look at it. Several times in preceding chapters, Isaiah quotes God as referring to Israel as my servant, but that's not necessarily the case here. There are many abrupt prophecies concerning Messiah in the book of Isaiah. Let me just show you a few. In Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, Ahaz, an ungodly king, was told by Isaiah to make any request of God that he wanted, and he kind of copped out on the whole thing. And Isaiah said, well, the Lord himself will give you a prophecy. Behold, a virgin shall be with child, a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel, or God with us. That's referring to Genesis chapter 3, where it said that the serpent's head would be crushed through the seed of the woman. Isaiah 9, 6 and 7, another amazing prophecy which gives us a little more insight into who this child would be. It says in verse 6, it says, for a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders. And there we see, even though it's not mentioned, we see the first and second comings. He says, and his name will be called Wonderful, Incomprehensible One, is what that means. Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. And that would qualify as Emmanuel, God with us. And he says, there will be no end to the increase of his government or peace. Again, this is the second coming, on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and uphold it with justice and righteousness. From then on and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. Or we could go to Isaiah chapter 11. All of a sudden he's talking prophetically and he throws in about the righteous branch. Again, Messiah says, then a shoot will spring from the stem of Jesse. And he's not talking about David. He's talking about Christ, because David was long ago, before Isaiah. And here we have a stem from Jesse, who would be Messiah. And he says, a branch from his roots will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him, such as we saw at the baptism of Christ. And the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and strength, no man spoke as Christ spoke, did they? The Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. And he will not judge by what his eyes see, nor make a decision by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he will judge the poor and decide with fairness for the afflicted of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked, referring to Revelation chapter 19 and verses 11 through 16 in the second coming. He says, and righteousness will be the belt about his loins, and faithfulness the belt about his waist. And then he talks about his millennial thousand-year reign that we see in Revelation chapter 12. He says, the wolf will dwell with the lamb. That's never happened before. The wolf eats the lamb these days. And the leopard will lie down with the young goat, same there. The calf and the young lion and the fatling together. And a little boy will lead them. Lucky kid. Also, the cow and the bear will graze, the young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The nursing child will play by the hole of the cobra, and the weaned child will put his hand on the viper's den. They will not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the water covers the sea. Then in that day, very prophetic phrase, the nations will resort to the root of Jesse. Who's that? Jesus Christ, who will stand as a signal for the peoples, and his resting place will be glorious. He will reign from Jerusalem on this earth for 1,000 years before the new heavens and new earth are established. If you want something closer to Isaiah 53 and Isaiah 42, another prophecy concerning the Messiah. Amazing, again, amazing prophecies. He said, behold, my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He'll bring forth justice to the nations. This wasn't just for the rulership of Israel. This was for the nations that he would bring forth justice. He says he will not cry or raise his voice, nor make his voice heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, speaking of Christ's wondrous compassion. In a dimly burning wick he will not extinguish. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not be disheartened or crushed until he has established justice in the earth. Christ himself will be the only one to do that. Then in Isaiah 49, verses 5 through 7, it talks about Israel, my servant, in the first few verses. But then in verse 49, he switches gears again, and he says, and now says the Lord, who formed me from the womb to be his servant, to bring back Jacob to him. Whoever this is that's being mentioned here was to bring Jacob back into a relationship, or Israel back into a relationship with the God of the universe, so that Israel might be gathered to him. For I am honored in the sight of the Lord, and my God is my strength. He says, is it too small a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob? Again, this servant was sent to raise up Jacob and to restore the preserved ones of Israel. I also make you a light of the nations, so that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. Again, a reference to Messiah, that he would be a world savior. Verse 7, thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel and its Holy One, to the despised one, the one abhorred by the nation. Notice he doesn't say nations, he says nations, because Christ was rejected by Israel. He says, to the servant of rulers, kings will see and arise, princes will also bow down, because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you. We'll talk more about that later, but Isaiah continually throws in wonderful nuggets about the Messiah as he goes through his prophecies. Add to that, some 40 times the pronoun he or him or himself is used in this chapter, referred to the servant of Jehovah in Isaiah chapter 53. It was he who bore the sins of Israel and ultimately the sins of the world, not Israel. Plus, he was an Israelite. Salvation came through Israel, not by Israel. He was a Jew who was rejected by his own people, as we're going to see. But he came for the purpose to save the house of Israel and ultimately anyone who would believe in the world, the Gentiles. You see, the book of Isaiah is full of messianic prophecies, so it shouldn't surprise us that Jehovah begins to speak of him again here in Isaiah chapter 53. It's both contextually and hermeneutically incredibly sound. So now that we've established that, let's look at the text. Remember, the series of messages was established from 1 Corinthians 15, verses 3 and 4, which says, Christ Jesus died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and Paul's referring to the Old Testament. He says he was buried and he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and again, referring to the Old Testament, and I believe he was referring to Isaiah 53 in particular. And I want to use 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4 as an outline for our study this morning. Because I, as I said, believed Isaiah 53 was the main passage in the Old Testament from which the Apostle Paul derived his information according to the Scriptures. And it could be only the Old Testament at the time he made that statement. So first of all, let's look at the fact Christ Jesus died for our sins according to the Scriptures. Look at Isaiah chapter 53, verses 1 through 8. Let's read it together. It says, who has believed our message? Question mark. And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of parched ground or barren ground. And he has no stately form or majesty that we should look upon him, nor appearance that we should be attracted to him. He was despised and forsaken of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and like one from whom men hide their face, He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely our griefs he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was pierced or wounded through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening of our well-being fell upon him, and by his scourging we are healed. All of us like sheep have gone astray. Each has turned to his own way, but the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to slaughter and like a sheep that is silent before its shears, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living for the transgression of my people, to whom the stroke was due? Incredible verses. Now again, there's so much here, it would be impossible to talk about it all in one sermon, for in eight verses, we have his birth, his humble origin, his rejection by Israel, his substitutionary sacrifice and atoning death, all described with absolute clarity in just eight verses. Amazing verses, as I said. Now notice, Isaiah begins with a question. Who has believed? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? That's because of the previous three verses in chapter 52, verses 13 through 15. Listen carefully as I read this. It says, behold, my servant will prosper. He will be high and lifted up and greatly exalted. That'll be the end of the whole deal. That's what we see at the end of the book of Revelation, isn't it? God takes his great power and Christ begins to reign. And he says, just as many were astonished at you, my people, so his appearance was marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. In other words, he didn't have any kingly presence. He didn't have any reigning power when he came the first time in the sense of worldly domination. And he says, thus he will sprinkle many nations. Kings will shut their mouths on account of him. For what had not been told them, they will see, and what they had not heard, they will understand. It's as if Isaiah is saying, who can believe that the servant of Jehovah would be brought from such depths of humiliation to so great heights of exaltation, so rejected and scorned and mocked and finally crucified, only to be raised from the dead and exalted above the heavens and seated at the right hand of power, and one day soon coming in great power and great glory to rule the nations, Matthew 24:30. Then the mouths of kings will be shut, and their blind eyes will see for the first time, and their feeble minds will comprehend, as Isaiah 9:7 intimates. But how can proud, pompous man believe such a message unless the Lord opens up his mind to believe? That's what that first questioning in verse 1 is all about. Then he says, for he grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of parched ground. He had no stately form or majesty that we should look upon him, nor appearance that we should be attracted to him. He was despised and forsaken of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. And like one from whom men hide their face, he was despised, and we did not esteem him or honor him, or you might even say glorify him. Simply put, Christ the Messiah came as the servant of men. That was Mark's favorite designation, the Son of Man. He came as a servant. He did not come to rule, but to save, John chapter 3. He did not come to judge, but again, he came to save, the first coming. He came from humble origins. He came out of parched ground. He was a carpenter's son. He wasn't born in a palace among the elite, but he was born in a stable with humble shepherds praising God for his coming. He had no earthly title, no royal crowns, no royal robes were upon him, no apparent earthly power or prestige, and he wasn't in with the in crowd of his day. He was scorned, he was ridiculed, he was rejected, and eventually crucified by the chief priests and the Pharisees and Sadducees and scribes and elders of Israel, the religious rulers of the day. He was not their buddy. He had no stately form or majesty. He came out of parched ground, as I said, nothing that would attract us in a worldly sense. In fact, his disciples were mostly despised Galileans. You know, Nathanael nailed it when he was said, when Andrew went to go find him, and he said, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And Nazareth was on the shores of Galilee or near it. He was a friend of tax gatherers and sinners, Luke chapter 7 tells us, and because of that, he was considered a glutton and a drunk by his opponents, by the religious elite, because of his association. Not true. And yet he healed hundreds, if not thousands. Sickness was virtually eliminated from Israel for 3 years wherever he went. Just incredible. He performed miracles that staggered the imagination, all the way from raising the dead to restoring body parts to feeding thousands with a single fish, or maybe a couple fish. It was amazing. And yet he was a man of sorrows. He grieved over our sin and unbelief and the hardness of our hearts, in particular Israel, as they hid their faces from him, despised him, and did not give him the esteem and honor that was due him as their coming Messiah. They missed the boat, so to speak. He did them only good. They returned to him, for the most part, only disrespect. Now listen to what John the Apostle has to say about this in John chapter 1, beginning in verse 9. He says, "There was a true light which coming into the world enlightens every man," speaking of Christ. He spoke of John the Baptist as a lamp. Christ was the true light. "He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own," speaking of Israel, "and those who are his own." Remember, repeatedly, Jesus said, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." So when he talks about his own, he's talking about Israel, and those who were his own did not receive him. But, I love that word, "but as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood or heritage," not because they were Abraham's offspring, "nor of the will of the flesh, to the works of the law, nor of the will of man, but of God." Those who believe God's message were saved, weren't they? They became the children of God, even as Israel was intended to be the children of God, the bride of Jehovah. Tragically, they rejected all that. Tragically, they rejected their Messiah. But that didn't alter the purpose for which he came. Look at verses 4 through 6. It says, "Surely our griefs he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, or struck down by God and afflicted. But he was pierced through," or wounded through. That's where the word piercing comes from, that it was all the way through. It wasn't just a slash wound or something like that, but he was pierced through for our transgressions, speaking to the nails. He was crushed for our iniquities, and the chastening of our well-being fell upon him, and by his scourging we are healed. All of us like sheep have gone astray, each has turned to his own way, but the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. Beloved, this is probably the greatest description of substitutionary atonement in all the Bible. Christ, the substitute for you and for me. Ever since Genesis chapter 3, as Elias showed us last week very ably, man has had a sin problem and has borne the consequences of that sin, ultimately eternal destruction, the wrath of God as he goes his hell-bound way. But Jesus took on the wrath of the Father in our stead. He bore our griefs. He carried our sorrows or pains. He was pierced through or wounded for our transgression. He was crushed for our iniquities. Our chastening fell on him. By his scourging, we are healed. God caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. That's one of the most incredible descriptions of substitutionary atonement you'll find anywhere. I don't care who wrote it at any time in history. In short, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. The ultimate sin-bearing Lamb, the perfect substitute. The wrath of God was satisfied, as 1 John 2:2 says, Christ is the propitiation, and that big word simply means Christ is the satisfaction for our sins, and not ours only, but for those of the whole world. And what he means by that is not that everybody's going to be saved, but that the grace of God at the cross through Christ was great enough to save every human being who has ever lived. But then there's still the believing. And as many as believed him, to them he gave the right to become the children of God. So, but the grace was infinite. You see, we are such sinners. I mean, sinner man. I think there's a song named that, isn't there? Anyway, goes sinner man, what you gonna do now? Something like that. We are such sinners. All of us like sheep have gone astray. Each has turned to his own way. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But Christ took on himself our sin, bore the wrath of God towards sinners, struck down by God, as verse 4 says, as the Lord caused our iniquity to fall on him. And I thought about that. I thought about John Bunyan's book where he said, grace abounding to the chief of sinners. You know, I love 1 Corinthians 5:21. I think it's Pastor Craig's favorite verse. It says, God made him, Christ, who knew no sin, to be sin on our behalf. And we call that the doctrine of propitiation, which is really a very close doctrine to the doctrine of substitutionary atonement, because imputation is the fact that Christ died for our sins and he took on our sin and credited it to his perfect account. Then he took his righteousness as the perfect sacrifice, the perfect atonement, and he credited it to our sinful account, canceling out our sin. It's very much an accounting term, and thank God it's an accounting term, because I won't say it's a matter of dollars and cents, but I think faith is faith in the reliability of the facts. And the fact is, Christ took on our sin and credited us with his righteousness. Now listen to Isaiah sums up the Messiah dying for our sins in verses 7 and 8. He says he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth like a lamb. Think of Christ's trial. Yet he did not open his mouth like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before his shearers, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living for the transgression of my people, for whom the stroke was due? Now, during that whole time of his trial, Christ was subjected to lying, false witnesses, everything you can imagine, false teaching, ultimately, because they accused him of blasphemy, and so on and so forth. In fact, in Matthew chapter 20, he sums up what would happen to him. And he went through all this willingly. In fact, he set his face like a flint to go to Jerusalem for it to happen. And in Matthew chapter 20, verse 17, he says, as Jesus was about to go up to Jerusalem, he took the 12 disciples aside by themselves, and on the way he said to them, behold, you are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles to mock and scourge and crucify him. And on the third day, he will be raised up. Amen. And again, the disciples were grieved because they didn't get it. They didn't understand that he would be raised again. They didn't understand sacrificial atonement and so on and so forth in the final sense of that Christ was the ultimate final Passover lamb, that he was the ultimate sacrificial lamb. Now, during that whole time, he conducted himself in the as the ultimate Lamb of God. Though oppressed and afflicted, he refused to defend himself or to retaliate, which he could have. He could have suspended everybody 5 feet off the ground or 10 feet off the ground and walked around and preached the gospel to him. That was within the power he had to do, but that wasn't the purpose. He needed to be the atonement for our sin. But during that whole time, he didn't retaliate. He did not open his mouth except once. Once he was asked, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the living God?" Question too good to pass up. He answered, "You have said it yourself. Nevertheless, I tell you, hereafter you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." In other words, "I will die, I will rise, I will ascend to the right hand of the Father, I will wait for the appropriate time, and I will come to reign at the second coming." Now those were, in essence, his last words to the nation of Israel. There were words on the cross, but those, in essence, were the last words to the nation of Israel. As Daniel 9:26 says, at the end of the 69 weeks of years, Messiah would be cut off and have nothing. He came to his own, and they rejected him. As verse 8 says, by oppression and judgment, he was taken away. Why? For the transgression of my people was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, to whom the stroke was due. They were teaching a gospel, John the Baptist and Christ, of a gospel of repentance from sin, for the kingdom of God is at hand. He was speaking of Israel in Isaiah 53, but really it applies to all of us, doesn't it? We all need the Redeemer. We all need to be delivered from our sin. Tragically, Israel rejected her own Messiah and incurred a partial hardening, as Paul tells us in Romans chapter 11, until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Until that day, when Zechariah 12:10 tells us, they will look upon me whom they have pierced, and they'll mourn for me as one mourns for an only son. They will finally, in the last days, Israel will recognize that Jesus was the Messiah, and that hardening will be taken away, the softening of the heart will happen, and repentance will come to Israel. That'll be a glorious day. So we see Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. And secondly, verse 9, he was buried according to the Scriptures. And I love this. He says, his grave was assigned with wicked men, yet he was with a rich man in his death, because he had done no violence, nor was there deceit in his mouth. Now, a lot could be said here, but I'm going to just capsulize it. If you're familiar with the crucifixion account, you know that Christ, our Lord, was crucified between two criminals, two wicked men, and they were wicked. They deserved what they were getting. And he would have been given a criminal's burial, probably an unmarked grave or possibly burned to ashes. But at this point, enter Joseph of Arimathea, a disciple of Jesus, Matthew 27:57, who went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus, which Pilate granted to him, and he buried Jesus in his own newly hewn garden tomb, which was hewn out of a huge rock or a rock outcropping, and Christ was placed in that tomb. Amazingly. So by God's sovereign design, as Matthew 27:57 says, there came a rich man. Notice that rich. He was with a rich man in his death. He was buried in a rich man's tomb. The rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, according to the Scriptures. Isaiah prophesied this hundreds of years prior. Then look at the last two lines of verse 9, again, he says, because he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. In other words, he was sinless. What a mouthful could be said here. Pilate declared him innocent, yet then cowardly had him crucified. One of the thieves on the cross, as they're hurling abuse at him, finally declared, he said to the other thief, he said, we indeed are suffering justly, for we are receiving what we deserve for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong. And I would add this was the perfect sinless Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, either in the redemption of the believing sinner or in the eternal judgment of the unrepentant unbeliever. So we see he was buried according to the scriptures, was prophesied hundreds of years earlier in Isaiah chapter 53. Then lastly, we see in verses 10 through 12 that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Let's read verses 10 through 12. It says, but the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to death. Who put him to death? To grief. The Lord, Jehovah. If mark that in your Bible, if he would render himself as a guilt offering, he will see his offspring, he will prolong his days, the good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand. As a result of the anguish of his soul, don't just think of Jesus' physical suffering on the cross. Think of what he went through as he was bearing the wickedness and sin of the world, the perfect Lamb of God taking on the sin of the world. It's unimaginable. You know, a doctor would tell us that Christ died of a broken heart. Literally, his heart burst. From the grief of that, he bore our griefs. But then it says, my servant will justify. As a result of the anguish of his soul, he will see it and be satisfied. I'm not sure whether that refers to the Father being satisfied with the sacrifice or Christ being satisfied that it was finished. It has something to do with all of it. But he says, by his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will justify the many as he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great. Has a good ending, doesn't it? And he will divide the booty with the strong. Because he poured out himself to death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, yet he himself bore the sin of many and interceded for the transgressors. Now, what an incredibly resounding conclusion to this whole passage. The passage just screams, he is risen. He is risen. And I mean, it's just screaming resurrection of this wonderful servant who died in our stead. The passage reeks with resurrection power. But the Lord, verse 10, was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief. Who was it that crucified Jesus? Was it the Jews? Was it the Romans? Was it us? No, it was the Father putting him to death. Why? For the sins of the people. Because the Father wanted to redeem us. You know, repeatedly Jesus said in the Gospels, I came not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me, or the will of my Father. The night before the crucifixion, he's praying, Father, you can let this cup pass from me. And then he states, but nonetheless, not my will, but thine be done. He did the will of the Father. Notice the if in this passage. It's huge. If he would do this, if he would carry out the Father's will, if he would die a substitutionary death, if he would be the Lamb of God, it would have such staggering results that we can't even imagine. Someday in the Someday in eternity, we will understand the staggering results of that if. And Christ willingly fulfilled it. You know, it tells us that sometime in eternity past, in the predetermined counsel of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that this was determined in Christ determinately and willingly carried it through. Acts 2:23, Peter's preaching, and he's preaching to the Jewish first sermon that he was preaching in Jerusalem, and he said, this man delivered up by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, you nailed to a cross by the hands of godless men and put him to death. Couldn't be any more clear, could it? You know, I love John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son because the son was willing to be the sacrificial lamb. And what was the result of all this? Well, one result was our redemption and the redemption of all who will believe. Look at verse 11 again. He says, as a result of the anguish of his soul, he will see it and be satisfied. By his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will justify the many as he will bear their iniquities. And then the end of verse 12, he says, because he poured out himself to death, he was numbered with the transgressors, yet he himself bore the sins of many and interceded for the transgressors. You know, even today, even after we've been saved, it says that Christ intercedes for us at the throne of God. You know, what a marvelous thing. His first intercession was at the cross as he bore our sins before the Father and took our wrath on that was meant for us because we're sinful and wretched before God. You know, the greatest result from our standpoint is our eternal redemption and the forgiveness of our sins. I love Colossians 1, 13 and 14, which says, God rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have what? Redemption, the forgiveness of our sins. There's nothing like forgiveness. And because of his anguish of soul, because he was willing to pour out himself unto death, the wrath of God, verse 11, was satisfied in mercy and justice kissed at the cross as Jesus was numbered among the transgressors, bearing our sins and interceding for us, justifying the many of us who would believe in him. Again, we're saved by grace. So one result was our redemption. But an even greater result of all this was the exaltation and glorification of our Lord. That's what he brings out amazingly in this passage. Notice, because he willingly carried out the Father's will for the redemption of men, look at the results. He will see his offspring. Literally, he will see his seed. I think of Romans 8:17, that because of that, we're adopted sons of God, we're heirs of God, we're joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Hebrews 2 calls us, he's not ashamed to call us brothers. We're the sheep of his pasture, the bride of the groom, the body of Christ. We're the church, the called out ones, the ecclesia. And someday Israel in the last days will look upon him whom they have pierced, and they will become his saved ones again. Paul tells us in Romans 11 that thus all Israel will be saved when the times of the Gentiles are over. And then he says he'll prolong his days. That speaks of resurrection. Death won't hold its prey, will it? As the song says, he conquered sin and death at the cross and the resurrection. And it says the good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand. You know, I think of the high priestly prayer. And it kind of grieves me that people are so willing to overlook the book of Revelation in their study. Because Christ's high priestly prayer was, and now restore to me the glory which I ever had with thee before the world was. And the book of Revelation is all about the restoration of that glory, isn't it? You know, this is the revelation of Jesus Christ. That's how the book starts out. And what is revealed in here is the majesty of Christ. John sees him and falls at his feet as a dead man, which is hard to imagine. The one who leaned on Christ's breast at the Last Supper, and here he falls at his feet because he is overcome with the glory that he sees. The good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand. And Revelation 11:16 tells us right in the middle of the book of Revelation that he will take his great power and begin to reign. He'll actually take up an earthly reign over this world as he destroys it to rebuild it again. Then it says in verse 12, therefore I'll allot him a portion with the great, and he will divide the booty with the strong. I'm not exactly sure what that means, but I understand that all will be his. We're a joint heir with Jesus Christ. In him we inherit everything. You see, all this speaks of resurrection power and the glorification of the Son. Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, was buried, and arose on the third day according to the Scriptures. Now, let me close by reading you a passage from the New Testament, which I believe summarizes what we've just seen in Isaiah 53. And I think as Paul was writing this, he may have been reading Isaiah 53. But look at Philippians chapter 2 and verses 3 through 11. Let me just read it as we close. He says, "Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind," mark that, "regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. Have this attitude, this humility of mind in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself." Why did he empty himself? For you and me. That's why he emptied himself. To save sinners like us. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to what? The Father's will. Nobody would want to go through what Christ went through for us. Both the physical pain was unbelievable. But the spiritual pain must have been unbearable. But he was obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Horrible way to die. He says, "For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow of those in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord," to what? To the glory of God the Father. Amazing, amazing thing that Isaiah records is utter humiliation. I mean utter humiliation. If you were the Son of God, to go through what Isaiah describes would just be utterly humbling and humiliating in every respect. But then unequaled exaltation. He went through it for his own glory, for his own praise, to be glorified by the Father, who once again restored to me the glory which I ever had with thee before the world was, and that he might glorify his Father in heaven. Incredible passage. This Resurrection Sunday, let's celebrate all our risen Lord has accomplished on our behalf. But even more than that, let's celebrate him, and that he's coming soon in power and great glory, for he is risen, and he did it according to the Scriptures. He is risen indeed. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that it is so amazing and so powerful. And Lord, I just pray that it moves each one of our hearts to think of what Christ went through on our behalf. And yet at the same time, understand with great joy the fact that he has been exalted above the heavens, that every knee will bow, every tongue confess that he is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And we long for that day. We long to see him totally exalted in our eyes. We long for that day when we will dwell with him in heaven and see him as he is, and we will be transformed to his likeness. What a marvelous promise. And thank you this Resurrection Sunday for what you've done on our behalf, because you conquered sin and death, and you died and you rose again victorious over sin and death. And Lord, that someday you're coming soon, and someday we'll be in your presence, whether it be through life or death. And we just praise you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's close with one last song of worship to the risen Lord.
Well, have a blessed resurrection day. Let me just close with these verses from Jude chapter 1, verses 24 and 25, where he says, "Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory, blameless with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen." God bless you.